Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we're going to make this fun fall card, and we're going to do some alcohol marker coloring, and I'm going to be giving away these stamps today on my blog. Make sure you go over to thefrugalcrafter.wordpress.com and sign up to win these beautiful stamps from our sponsor, artneco.com. We're going to do some masking today, so the first thing we need to do is stamp our images on some post-it notes. And since I don't have post-it notes that are big enough for this wagon, I'm actually going to put two side-by-side, stamp on it, and then attach the two pieces together with some clear tape. That way I will have a mask that I can use over and over again. Then I'm going to stamp each pumpkin two times, cut those out, and then that will be all I need to do for my masking. I have a piece of smooth white cardstock on my table, and I'm working on top of a pad of newsprint from the children's area at the dollar store. That's where I picked those up. And I am stamping on the wagon. Notice I don't have any cushion on my stamp. I am just using the raw red rubber on my rock-a-block. I always get a great impression that way, especially if I stamp on a phone book, an old magazine, or a pad of newsprint. Now, the mask that I made for the wagon, all I did was cut along the top edge of the wagon because I knew I wasn't masking around the wheels or anything, so that's all I needed to do. And I'll save that mask to use again. Now I am stamping some of the pumpkins in. I've got one of the big pumpkins in, and then I thought I would switch to maybe one of the smaller ones, just so I get a good variety. And you can turn your pumpkins, you can have them upside down, you can have them lower in the wagon. What you want is to have them look a little bit different from one another so you don't have a bunch of pumpkins that look the same. After you have a few in there that aren't touching each other, you want to put your masks down on top. So when you trim your mask out, you just want to make sure you cut them really close and maybe even cut off the stamped lines just so you don't get a weird halo when you go to stamp on top. So now that I've protected those three pumpkins and the wagon, I can go ahead and stamp a few more pumpkins on. It's a really fun technique. It's probably one of the best techniques you can learn to get the most versatility from your stamps. If you want to add more pumpkins, simply move your masks up to the top pumpkins and keep on stamping until you have as many pumpkins in the wagon as you like. When you remove the masks, when you're done stamping, you are going to see a beautiful composition with all of your pumpkins sitting in the wagon, just as if they all came from one big stamp. I love this because it makes your stamps more versatile. You could fill this adorable wagon with fruits, vegetables, bags of leaves, Christmas ornaments, Christmas trees, you name it. It makes a stamp so much more versatile. I decided I wanted to color this image with alcohol markers. You can use whatever brand you want. You just want to choose a medium brown color to begin. And since I'm using alcohol markers, I'm using Memento ink, and the paper I'm working on is a smooth cardstock. It's actually Nina Classic Crest, which I find encourages my markers to blend, my alcohol markers to blend a lot more than other brands. But you could totally use whatever smooth cardstock you have. It just might blend a little bit less, but that's not a huge deal. Also, if you wanted to use watercolor markers, you totally could. I would recommend using an archival ink for that, though, so the ink doesn't smear when you go to blend. And if you have watercolor paper, that's actually a little bit better if you want to use watercolor markers or watercolor pencils. And you can also use colored pencils. Color it however you like. Now, as always, I prefer to go in and put my darkest colors in first. For me, I find it handy because it helps me establish value. I know that's not how everybody does it, and you can do it however you prefer, but that just helps me figure it all out. Once I feel like I have all of those shadows in, I'm going to go in with a much lighter taupe color, and I'm going to color over everything. And that's going to let those shadows blend out a little bit and give me kind of like a mask color to the wagon. So just go ahead and color over everything, all of the wood in that wagon, with that lighter taupey brown. Now I'm using a middle value gray to add some of the shadows of the metal wheel rims here on this wagon. You could also keep your wagon wood. You could use red and make like painted wagon wheels that are red. You can use whatever colors you like. I just thought this kind of gray would look nice and neutral and enhance the pictures. But as always, you put the colors that you want to put down. It's your picture. Now I've switched to a deeper, richer brown, and I am adding some of the darker shadows in the wagon. I'm enhancing over some of the original dark portions I put down that weren't quite dark enough, and I also put the spokes in on the wagon wheels and some of the shadows on the inside of the rim. It just helps to make your detail stand out and give it a little bit more of a three-dimensional look. The pumpkins were so fun to color. I started off with this kind of rich, spicy, orangey brown color, and I'm going in and putting the the colors in the shadow areas of the pumpkin. Now, a quick tip for you. Sometimes you'll be working with markers and the colors of the labels or the ends could be a bit deceiving. I recommend making a color swatch chart you can keep with your markers. It'll save you time and it will save your projects because you won't grab the wrong color by mistake. And it'll also save your ink because you won't have to swatch out so many colors before you begin coloring a project. I also found with this color, these orangey browns are very easy to blend, so I can go in and actually put all of my shadows in at one time. This saves so much time over coloring each pumpkin individually. Now, if you're coloring like a bright purple or bright like hot pink color flower, you might have to do every petal one at a time because they just that color tends not to blend very well. But I find these spicy browns and oranges blend so very well. So I went ahead and put all of the shadow colors in all of the pumpkins all at once. Then I switched to a bright orange and I'm coloring over the shadow and about half of the area that's left. Now remember, you don't have to color every pumpkin the exact same way. You can leave some with more white space for your yellow highlights, and you can leave some with hardly any white space left for your yellow highlights. All pumpkins are different, the light's hitting them differently. Having that subtle variation between the pumpkins will give them a little bit more life and realism in your design. So you want to do that for every pumpkin. And now I'm using a nice sunny yellow to go over the orange and finish coloring in each of the pumpkins. So you want to overlap that bright orange and that is going to help the color blend. You can see how easily those colors blend. It's funny, certain colors stain the paper and certain colors blend really easily, just like with watercolors. So finish filling in your pumpkins and then we're going to do the stems and the leaves. The stems and leaves are pretty simple. I just used a combination of an olivey green color and my bright yellow to fill them in and highlight them. And that's really all there is to it for coloring that. Now we get to work on the background and those acorns that I stamped around the wagon. I like to put backgrounds in because I'm not crazy about having all that white paper there. Now, something you could have done if you wanted to mask off the acorns and cut the mask really closely around the wagon, you could just mask it and sponge in some distress ink or whatnot. But I really love doodling with the markers, so I'm using the chisel edge here because it's a nice sharp end, and I'm sketching in some grasses to kind of give the wagon a little bit of weight and place in the composition. And now I'm coloring in right over those grasses I drew to soften them and all over the ground part of the composition with a lighter green marker. And just take your time getting in between the spokes of the wheels. Now I'm going back to that first color I used, the darker olivey green, and I'm adding some shadows under the wheels, under the wagon. This is going to give the wagon a little more weight and make it feel like it's really sitting on the ground. I love to work in a really sketchy fashion when I'm doing this. You can be a little more precise if you want, and if this kind of freaks you out, you can always try it on a scrap piece of paper first and see if you like it. If not, maybe sponging a little bit of ink on there with a makeup sponge might be just enough background for you. It's completely up to you, like I said before. This is your card. It should make you happy. I decided I wanted to warm up the ground because it is fall and, you know, grass would be kind of dead and hayish. So I went in with a really pale yellow, a pale warm yellow, and went over the area in the ground and also grabbed some of that color and pulled it up into the sky. For the sky, I'm going to use a really light blue to just kind of tone that area of the paper. You may notice that when working with really pale colored alcohol markers, they feel kind of dry, much more drier than your darker colored markers. And that's a case with this. Even though it's a brand new marker, I colored really quickly and it left a lot of streaks, but that's all right because I didn't want a ton of color. Now I've turned the marker around and I'm going in with the brush tip and I'm putting in some kind of swirly loopy lines to kind of get the streaks out of the sky and give it more of a mottled cloudy look. And that way I can also get in real close around the pumpkins and make sure there's no halo around the cart. The acorns are colored the same way, going dark to light with different shades of brown, and then I added a little splash of that light green that I put over the grass just to kind of green them up a little bit and make them look a little more realistic. If you're happy with your coloring job so far, you can leave it as is, but if you'd like to enhance it more, you can grab some colored pencils. I think this is a great technique in case you don't have a huge marker collection, or if you just feel like you need a little bit more richness to your piece. And I'm using the new Spectrum Color Blend pencils from Spectrum Noir, and I find they do a really nice job at just kind of tinting here. And since this is a really smooth paper, it's not going to take a lot of color. It's almost like trying to color on glass because this paper is so smooth. So it's just going to let me enhance things a little bit and kind of sweeten up the picture a little bit. It's a great technique, and I do hope you try it on your next project. Now let's build a card. I'm going to begin by tearing the edges of this panel that we spent so long coloring just to give it a kind of rustic feel. I mounted some pretty decorative paper on a 5-inch by 7-inch craft card base, and then I'm using some patterned grosgrain ribbon across the center. I thought this pumpkin orange would just be the perfect embellishment for this card. To give that panel that we spent so long coloring some dimension, I'm going to use foam squares on the back, and that will lift it up and make it a little more substantial. I also wanted to mention that if you wanted a more distressed look, you could use a brown ink pad to ink the edges of that panel before sticking it down, and it would make it stand out and give it a little more of a vintage feeling. But that's completely up to you. I wanted a more light, fresh vibe on my card. Now I want to add a little bit more embellishing, so I am going to glue down some buttons. I've got some teal and orange buttons, and I think that's all this card really needs. Of course, you could get a lot fancier with your embellishments, and please do if that's what you want, but I really like the simple look of this card. If you want to win the stamps that I used, make sure you head on over to my blog, thefrugalcrafter.wordpress.com, and leave a comment on the post featuring this card for a chance to win. I will draw a winner in 1 week. I want to thank ArtDeco.com for sponsoring today's post. You can find links to all the products I used in the video description, and check out their stamps because they have the biggest selection of Asian inspired stamps that I've ever seen, and they never go out of style. Thank you so much for watching. Please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. Until next time, happy crafting!